bit.
Are the cats?
You can hurt, but I'm good.
Shh. Everyone, all right. Next panel.
That was really good, much better than me, and I went on for about a minute. So, all right, good morning, everybody. So we will tackle the topic of monetization. So our actual topic is how to get your client to spend $1 million in mobile now. So we'll, of course, talk about some of the basics in terms of inventory and ad sizes, but also talk about just basic ideas of really what is happening with the mindset of the CMO, and we will go through a forum which really touches on three areas. So first, we're going to set the stage. We'll talk about what the average mobile buy looks like, so we'll probably have questions about that. Second, we'll go through and build the case. So we'll talk about what should brands and their agencies be thinking about when it comes to mobile. I think you've heard a lot about that, but we'll have a little bit of a twist to it in terms of what are the expectations and what are people thinking. And then lastly, we'll talk about making mobile mandatory and, you know, where is mobile's role in the media mix to sort of sum up everything. So just a couple quick numbers before we dig into the intros. So the first thing, if you are a CMO, there are probably a small handful of items you're thinking about. Up here, as a group, we've shown the top seven items that are on people's minds in the CMO role. So of course, they're looking to use media for branding, promotion, positioning, et cetera. And what we need to figure out is how can mobile be part of each of these items? In terms of revenue, so right now in the US this year, there'll be just about $160 billion of advertising spend. The online part of that, which will include mobile, is about $40 billion. And when you break this down, this year we'll do about $2.6 billion just for mobile. So that's about 5% of online, about 1.7% of the total. But the good news, there's about 110 million people in this country with smartphones. Just over half of those folks are using a browser for some activity. So between browser and in-app, there's a lot of action, there's a lot of people. And so what we'll do now, we'll go through quick intros for the team. So Michael, if you could give a little background. And
sure. Morning, everyone. My name is Michael Collins. I'm the CEO of Joule. We are a mobile agency. We're a mobile specialist agency. That's all we do. We are part of the WPP family. We also act as mobile specialist agency for Group M. So we tend to be involved with campaigns that really do go all the way throughout the purchase funnel from start to finish. And I think if I know Mort had asked for one thought as to what are we seeing make the clients tick up, and I think it's probably just that, being able to look at mobile not just as a campaign or one execution, but really how can mobile be deployed across the purchase funnel, looking at multiple touch points, how to establish and maintain dialogue for an ongoing relationship with the customer. That's really where the power of mobile can come in.
Cool, thank you. Mr. Finnegan.
It's Sean Finnegan, a Chief Strategy Officer at Akoo. We are a national location-based digital video network with mobile infusion. With the power of our app and SMS, there's an on-demand platform that we reach about 50 million people per month. I think,
being the video guy, we have a video for you.
Oh, you do? Well,
we do.
All right, it's pretty exciting.
All right, we are going to see the video. Video's being cued.
Show you some of our friends at Akoo.
See?
So I think the one thought that I'd love to bring to the table here today is in the conversation in terms of mobile dollars and revenue and allocations is in the sense of mobility. You know, not necessarily just sticking to a one-dimensional app or SMS, but just how we can start to broaden our scope and reach and budgets to our targets as they're living their lives, as they're moving around.
Cool. And Jonathan from Activision, you see video like that all the time. It's super exciting. So give us a sense of what you're doing and what's on your mind about mobile.
Sure. At Activision, we're the largest game publisher in the world, and we have kind of a bifurcated view of mobile. On one hand, mobile is a product, and we do very kind of nuts and bolts marketing, and I think it's probably a little less interesting to most of this room, you know, to sort of promote those games. But on the other hand, mobile is a big advertising platform for our core console business, and I think that probably reflects more of the experience in this room, and that's where I'll try to focus my comments today.
Cool. And then rounding us out, we've got a very creative officer person. So Chris, introduce yourself and give us a sense of what you're seeing from mobile.
Sure. Hello. I'm Chris Ferguson. I'm Executive Creative Director of Tribal DDB here in New York. And I didn't bring any samples to show today because I'm very new to the Tribal family. This is my third week. Prior to Tribal, I was with RGA for many, many years, where I was part of the Google team and also part of the Nike team. So contributing to some of the work that you're going to see today.
Cool. So across the board, we've got a great creative group. And so we're going to dig in. We'll talk about the first item in terms of setting the stage. So what does the average mobile buy look like? So Michael, are buys annual or opportunity driven? And what are you seeing as an average budget?
Sure. I think we're seeing a lot of both. Like with any new channel, there are clients who are at a different point of absorbing mobile, how they're using it. We do have some clients who are fully committed. It's part of their marketing mix. And they have the ability to plan on an annual basis. But across the board, even our clients have been doing mobile for a while, that's maybe 10%, 15% of the client base who are committed enough and have a structured enough planning process so they can be looking at it on an annual basis. The rest of the group, for those who are less committed or just have a more ad hoc planning process, they're structuring campaign by campaign or season by season. As far as the budget size, I think for those who are sort of in the test phase, who are still, you know, perhaps not fully committed or not fully committed across all their brands within a larger group, we're probably seeing test buys anywhere from 20, 50, maybe up to 100K, which is good enough to get some learnings, see how the brand responds. For those who are fully committed, we're seeing everywhere from, you know, starting there 100K up to some of the larger brands who are putting up to 10 million into the mobile space. So it's very much across the board, but I think for a very young and still maturing channel like mobile, it's probably somewhat par for the course.
So mobile is like dating. It's all about commitment. But the good news is there's certainly at least $1 million of spend, and in some cases up to 10 million or more. So is there difficulty when talking to brands, and, you know, is there a conversation, and this can be open to anyone or Jonathan or Michael, you know, when the brands sit down and think mobile, you know, do they think a percent, or are they thinking, you know, native applications? You know, what's the mindset to get to budget inside of a CMO's head?
Well, our mindset is goal. I don't think we ever start with we're going to spend 3% on mobile or 5% on mobile. Is that getting back? So we're looking to goal, and we're also looking sort of our marketing philosophy is around beats as opposed to sort of annualized plans. So depending on where we are in the cycle, we'll either spend more or less on mobile.
Got it. All right. So goals. Anyone else? Chris, you know, RGA time. So what was the mindset as people were beginning the planning for mobile?
Sure. I mean, I think mobile is a very interesting channel because it's of such a personal nature. So we all are very personally connected to our mobile devices. Most of us go through the routine in the morning of wallet, keys, phone before we leave the home. And I would venture to guess that if we forgot our keys or our wallet, we might continue about our day, but no one's leaving without their mobile. We're connected to it day in and day out. So I think the mindset has to be, how do we get ourselves invited into, as a brand, how do we get ourselves invited into this very personal space? And it's a challenge. So you really have to start with the mindset of the consumer and the behaviors of the consumer to get into that very specific personal space.
And I think I'll add the marketing opportunities, because our challenge is we see the percent of time our audience is spending moving up with mobile every day, but there isn't always the marketing or advertising opportunities that we think have the impact relative to that share of time.
Got it. So how do you come up with a big idea then? So Sean, when you're in the studio with these guys, what sort of the mindset and conversation about coming up with a big idea? Forgetting budget, thinking of course about some of the goals, but how do you get to the big idea?
Yeah, and typically the big ideas drive big budget. When you go after budget, you tend to get smaller dollars and smaller thinking. Well, that's sort of the experience we've had with brands. But I think one of the elements too that, to the last question from a planning perspective, is because of the personal nature of the device, and also because of the sophistication of the brands down to the local store level data reading, you're starting to see a lot more RFPs that are not necessarily cost per action oriented, but they're driven by how much actual activity is going to be driven into foot traffic, into store level sales, into ticket prices, and also return visits.
So I guess the topic of behaviors. So Chris, how do behaviors and brand truths come together and intersect for mobile, and sort of what's the thinking from the consumer side?
Sure. I mean, I think I would answer that with an example that's one of my favorite from recent memory is Band-Aid did this app called Mobile Vision, where it was very simply an app that animated a Band-Aid. So it's really intersecting a moment that those of us with children can relate to. When your child is hurt, crying, you're applying a Band-Aid, all you want to do is distract that child and have that child stop crying and think about something else. So to me, that's just a brilliant example of thinking about a real moment in someone's life and intercepting it with an app that does exactly what the parents want and exactly what the children want at that time. So I think the opportunity is really to start with examining what those behaviors are and then thinking about what the application is that's going to make the most sense and be the most interesting. I mean, that is just one example that I think really highlights meeting a need for parents at a particular moment, but also for children, and doing it in a very, very interesting way.
Got it. All right, so I got a note from the back that they're having trouble hearing us a little bit. So I know we had some feedback, but try and speak a little closer. I will do the same.
Meeting back.
So the feedback I got was parent reaching around the pole saying, speak into the microphone. So great. So it sounds like the big takeaways in terms of setting up to get budget has to do with goals, has to do with figuring out the big idea, and really approaching this essentially the same way you would any other medium. So it's about packaging. It's about the creativity behind this. So let's talk a little bit about what brands and their agencies are thinking about when it comes to mobile, specifically on the usage perspective. So how does usage compare when it comes to, people's time spent, and then the budget? And I know we've always seen the Mary Meeker charts and others where usage is way up here, but spend is down. And sort of, is that a conversation that you're having in your office? Is that a concern, or is it just we got to keep coming up with more big ideas?
I don't think it's a concern. I mean, we're looking at our data more than the macro data. We're looking in often instances 30 or 40% of our video views are coming from a mobile device. We're looking at site traffic, and so we're adjusting our spend based on our specific consumer behaviors, not, with a primary target of men 18 to 34, you can imagine a great deal of our activity is shifting towards mobile.
Got it. All right, so the expectation, what is that expectation from each of you that you're hearing that clients want, and what is the expectation that earns respect for a mobile campaign?
I think it's setting, I think where you get the respect is from meeting the expectation. Setting expectation mobiles right now, given that it is still relatively new, is not always the easiest thing to do. A lot of campaigns, a lot of business challenges that we're addressing day in and day out in mobile really haven't been done before. The exact match hasn't been done before, so there's not a huge body of learnings and knowledge to come from, which I think also attributes to the fact that a lot of the mobile activity right now is still in that test phase. So I think once that body of knowledge increases, once we do have those proof points, once the business models that are driving this business are going to be more identified, ROIs can be developed, expectations can be set and met with a greater degree of consistency, and that's going to start bringing a lot of dollars into this space.
Chris, how much is spent on creative? Are our clients coming in obsessing over certain types of rich media or ad executions for mobile, or are they coming in saying, hey, this is the goal, you know, what do you think we should do?
Well, I always try to redirect the conversation so it is about the goal and not specifically about the spend. And I think, you know, you can look at different examples that have paid off from a brand level versus a retail level. I mean, Nike Plus is a tremendous example of paying off on a brand level. I mean, you can't talk about Nike Plus without talking about Nike Running and then the halo effect for the other brands as well. So the goal there, you know, is not specifically about driving a specific dollar amount, but really creating an experience and amplifying something that people are already doing. So, you know, I don't know the exact metrics, but what it did was it got people who were running to run more, and it got people who were not running to start running. And that to me is a tremendous example of creating something that amplifies an existing behavior, but also has a halo effect on the brand. And people think extremely positively about Nike and Nike products as a result. But I think it also reflects, you know, you can also think of very specific retail examples, like Starbucks does a tremendous job in the mobile space about, you know, making your mobile about payment, so it becomes very transactional and it's less, you know, sort of supporting the brand at large.
And for us, it's really looking at target audience. Like, we have a kids' property, Skylanders, where the target audience is 6 to 11, and in that case, the mobile target is primarily tablet as a device, with sort of the parent pass along, where with Call of Duty, where it's sort of 18 to 34, the phone becomes the primary device targeted.
You know, I have to say that this is one platform where we can't make the mistake of other digital media to date, where you know, the web was just a translation of TV on a screen, and so we threw up some interruptive ad units, et cetera. And I think that we're going to probably follow suit if we're not talking more about advertising innovation and creativity within mobile. So, you know, we can talk about the thousands of different apps that are out there and the ability to reach a target, but we should be talking more about how you can take a brand's utility, their functionality, their programming, their assets, and build it into almost original entertainment, like into the mobile experience. I think if we just start throwing the sliver banners and just focus and rely just on search, on text, on mobile for growth's sake, it, you know, 5 years from now, this thing will just be, you know, inching up 3 to 5% and not to what it can.
Yeah, and that's a great point. And I think, you know, the panel before, certainly, they had spoke about, you know, what's native to the phone. So how do you click to call, click to route, click to save something to the calendar? And as we round out our last couple minutes up here, you know, let's use that as sort of the theme as we go across. But, you know, where is mobile's role in the media mix, and how do, you know, we think about innovation to go and push that conversation? And I'll open it up to each of you, whoever wants to jump in.
Well, I mean, I completely agree with Sean's point. I think when you're viewing mobile, you can't view it in a silo. You have to, at least from a creative perspective, view it as part of a program. But then I think the other part that complements that is, once you've established an idea for a program and where mobile fits in, I think the other part of it is really looking at it as a very specific element within that program. So you're developing, it's not a small TV. It's a very specific channel that we need to be thinking about. So, I mean, those two sides of the coin are really complementary. You know, what is the program first that we're thinking about? And then how does mobile behave within that program? So I think it's part of a broader spectrum of thinking.
Yeah, and I think for our business, mobile has a very proven role at the retail space upwards in sort of like consideration and search. Our challenge is finding like the pop culture breakthrough moments when we need like 80 or 90% awareness around a launch. And I don't think mobile's necessarily there yet with a combination of sort of instantaneous scale and kind of creative opportunity. You know, you talked about apps. We're kind of taking a big swing this year on an app with a third partner that we're not quite ready to talk about, because mobile advertising couldn't necessarily give us that sort of pop culture impact. So we found a mobile app-based property that had 8 million current users.
Terrific.
I'll just bring home that the point I brought up earlier is that it's just an opportunity to reach a consumer on the go.
You know, we're tethered to our other screens, but this isn't actually a device or a platform that you can reach them while they're, you know, certainly they're shopping, they're in their cars, or wherever, you know, you can meet, where physical meets digital.
I would agree. I think that's right on the mark. It's mobile should be viewed not as a set of devices, but as a set of behaviors. And I think the two really core set of behaviors that we're seeing now are just what Sean said. The consumer on the move, they have a small amount of time. They want to connect with their immediate environments, with their surroundings. That is very key. And the second, which I know was brought up very heavily in the panel before this, was mobile acting as the glue to connect to other channels. You know, 40% of tablet use is sitting on the couch while watching television. Television's becoming an interactive medium through tablets, through mobile. So I think those two areas, with the behaviors of consumers on the move and using mobile as that connective tissue to bring other channels together, that's mobile's role, and it's a very, very powerful place for it to be.
Cool. So innovation. So in the last 2-3 minutes that we have, what questions may be out there?
Get the mic. All right. Questions for our esteemed panelists. Come on, you can't feel. Ah, there's we go. Mr. Tim McHale, let me bring you the mic.
Hi. From a media planner standpoint, there seems to be a couple of tricks where you can, you know, maybe not have a mobile-centric plan, but find a way to get your message in through into the mobile medium. For example, adding an 800 number or your in your Google AdWords. Boom, you suddenly now have, you know, when your AdWords campaign comes up on mobile, clients can, you know, consumers can click on, or video, or social. I mean, these are things that in some ways where you don't necessarily have to have a mobile centric plan, video is absolutely a way that, you know, your message gets on to mobile. You know, there are always going to be, you know, this is a medium where people are creeping in versus, you know, jumping in with their mobile dollars. And I was just curious if there are any things that you guys can think of that, you know, media planners can think of ways to be able to accentuate that their digital solutions are going to have mobile relevance.
I mean, for us, I'd really say right now we're buying creative opportunities from partners more than media opportunities. You know, the media stuff is like steadily creeping up, but we found like if you can give us the big breakthrough idea, like I wish I could announce who we're doing this partnership with, but we're spending more on creative production within this app than we've ever spent on mobile media because it was a creative opportunity. So I think the big idea goes a long way in this space.
Even more so than the media. Let me just jump in on that one. So big creative idea is almost as important, if not more important, than the media. Kind of the battle between content and context. Yep.
Indeed.
Okay, sorry. That was my ad-libbing to the question. Any other questions in the audience? Come on, guys. You guys are so quiet.
All right.
See, the audience wants to keep you on time. Ooh.
One more. Michael Troxler, Rosetta. Quick question. We haven't really necessarily addressed the question of CRM and cross-platform CRM and how to go and leverage your conventional channels such as email and blend that with your mobile channels. So I know that there's a number of exercises going on this panel here. Anybody, any learnings there about blending your channels?
And for those in the back coming out, I've heard the first part. It had to do with CRM and blending email and mobile and just other CRM elements as well.
Well, I would say email is almost already is a mobile channel. When you look at, depending on who you're targeting, the amount of email that's being read on mobile devices, I would say that's kind of done. That's already happened. You know, mobile is a very powerful CRM tool in its own right, but again, where I think it's given a tremendous impact in CRM is be able to take that dialogue and the relationship to the consumer to places and environments where, as marketers, we haven't had that opportunity before. So we can keep that dialogue going to the point of purchase, through the aisles of the store, at checkout, as they're walking out the door. That doesn't necessarily replace any of the CRM efforts. It allows the ability to extend it and give us new touch points, new circumstances, new behaviors we can tap into. In that context, mobile can be a highly effective, highly powerful. It can extend our CRM efforts, again, into places where they haven't been before.
I think the one thing you got to take into consideration on that as well is the attribution conversation, where mobile is driving a tremendous amount of offline transactions. But you know, people are in the stores doing their real-time investigations on price point, and they're buying as much as they're not buying based on the data that they're researching. So if there's ever a media negotiation that is getting you down to a cost per price allocation, I would make sure that you're taking into consideration that that buy is not, you know, two-thirds of it is actually not going direct through the phone.
Okay. Another question over here.
Yeah, hi. Jürgen from Polymash Mobile. We're app developer and designers. So I like what you were saying earlier, saying, you know, that thinking of mobile as a set of behaviors. Now, usually from the end user perspective, the utility of those behaviors isn't aligned with the brand. It's not brand specific, with some, you know, exceptions. In other words, a restaurant finder app is more powerful from an end user perspective than a particular individual restaurant brand app. So is there an opportunity for brands to work together to take advantage of that sort of thing?
I would just say that, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be a behavior that's germane to the brand. It could be a behavior that exists or a new behavior that has come out of this new world that we live in. How are people functioning in the social space? How are people's behaviors changed because they're constantly connected with their mobile device? So it doesn't necessarily have to be germane to the brand itself. But what I think is important is to look at an existing behavior or find a behavior that's coming to light and find ways for the brand to be relevant and contextual in that space. Because not every brand has the opportunity to help you run more. So that's a unique positioning. But I think every brand has an opportunity to look at what people are doing and how things are changing, and then find ways to help them and provide, you know, utility is the word that we're going to hear a lot today, but provide utility to invite them into that very personal space, which is this mobile channel.
And I think that's key. There's 500,000 apps in the App Store. Brands, the world is littered with like dead brand apps. Like, if it's not relevant, it's not going to stick. Nobody's going to find it. Nobody's going to use it.
Any other questions? Going once, twice, sold. Thank you very much.
Guys, thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. All right.